After first joining the European Economic Community in 1973, the UK electorate voted to leave the EU on June 23, 2016. The Brexit referendum marked an abrupt end to 70 years of economic and political integration across Europe, and played out against a backdrop of rising populism across many Western countries. What factors led to Brexit? What drove the pressure to hold an EU referendum, and why did so many voters support the Leave campaign, which argued that EU immigration policies were breaking the UK healthcare system, and that remaining in the EU would erode workers' rights and allow UK public money to be spent on supporting corrupt EU bureaucrats? This paper studies the role of one potentially important factor in explaining the resonance of this populist message. Namely, the UK government's austerity measures and the subsequent shrinking of the welfare state. To provide some background, in the wake of the financial crisis, a Conservative Party-led coalition came to power in May 2010 and enacted a range of austerity measures aimed at reducing public sector deficits. The magnitude of these welfare reforms was substantial. Spending on welfare and social protection dropped by 16%, spending on healthcare flatlined despite the increased pressures of a rapidly aging population, and spending on education declined by 19%. At the district level, welfare spending per person fell by 23.4% between 2010 and 2015. The central question of this paper is, to what extent is there a direct line from these welfare cuts to the subsequent political upheaval of the Brexit vote? To tackle this question, the author uses detailed, high-frequency election data from the 2000s to study the evolution of support for the UK Independence Party, also known as UKIP. Prior to Brexit, UKIP was the only significant political party explicitly pushing for the UK to leave the European Union, and electoral support for the party serves as a good proxy for broader Leave sentiment. This figure shows that across European, local, and Westminster elections, the average UKIP vote share was fairly steady throughout the 2000s and then increased significantly after 2010. To break that aggregate trend down further, the author examines the extent to which UKIP vote shares at the district level are correlated with local demographics. For example, he compares how UKIP support varies with the fraction of local residents who have low levels of schooling. The results show that throughout the early 2000s, there is little correlation between UKIP support and this variable. Starting in 2010, however, this correlation suddenly becomes much stronger. Moreover, we see the same patterns if we look at the share of an area's working age population employed in routine jobs and the share employed in retail and manufacturing. All suggest that after 2010, UKIP started to thrive, especially in areas characterized by low educational attainment and a significant share of the local population working in routine jobs or in manufacturing or retail. So, why did support for UKIP shift so suddenly after 2010, and why was that shift concentrated in these particular areas of the country? The timing and distribution of these changes suggests that the government's austerity measures played an important role. To examine this more precisely, the author uses geographic variation in local exposure to the welfare cuts. While welfare spending per person fell by 23.4% over this period, that aggregate number hides substantial variation at the local level, with the sharpest reductions hitting the poorest areas of the country. Thus, the author compares how local support for UKIP evolved before and after 2010, in areas more exposed to the welfare cuts relative to those that were less exposed. The results point to a strong positive relationship between local exposure to the austerity measures and UKIP's electoral performance. Prior to the reforms, the relationship is flat. After 2010, however, there is a marked change. Relative to less exposed areas, support for UKIP increases substantially in areas hit the hardest by the welfare cuts. The corresponding magnitudes suggest that the austerity measures can explain an increase in UKIP support of between 3.5 to 11.9 percentage points by 2015. The author also uses individual-level data, where it is easier to cleanly measure exposure to the welfare cuts. Here, as well, he finds that the population exposed to reforms increased their support for UKIP and, in turn, their support for the Leave campaign in 2016. The results also point to a greater feeling of disenfranchisement and disconnect. Individuals exposed to the cuts increasingly perceive that their vote does not make a difference, that they do not have a say in government policy, and that public officials do not care. How significant are these results? Do they suggest that the government's austerity measures had any meaningful impact on the outcome of the 2016 Brexit referendum? A back-of-the-envelope calculation suggests that absent the impact of the austerity measures, support for the Leave campaign in 2016 could easily have been 6 percentage points lower. Given that Leave only won by a slim margin of 3.8 percentage points, and that support for UKIP is likely to understate the overall impact that austerity had on Leave sentiment, the author concludes that without austerity, Remain would likely have won the EU referendum. In conclusion, this paper provides evidence that the UK's austerity policies from late 2010 onward played a key role in the political upheaval leading to Brexit. Beyond this particular historic event, these results also speak to the potential importance of economic factors in driving the rise of populism. To read more on this topic, you can check out the full paper and its references to other related research. These include many papers studying factors behind the rise of populism, research on the interaction between exposure to austerity measures and individuals' political preferences, and finally, a growing body of work on Brexit.